Despite the fact that it was in the district center of Ukraine, it wasn't just a district club. His contemporaries respectfully called it a theater or a movie house. This video is closely related to the previous one, NKVD units in the German-Soviet War 1941-1945. Everything is connected, and here you will meet the participants of the previous video. Therefore, everything that is laid out on the channel needs to be looked into order. This channel is like a novel. Only the characters are real people, because the history of the theater isn't a building, but the people who worked there. We are interested in facts and people. We don't justify or condemn anyone, we don't have the right to do so, as we didn't live at that time. But the experience of those people shouldn't be wasted. It all started in 1933 when the All-Ukrainian Central Executive Committee and the Council of People's Commissars of the USSR issued a resolution on the construction of cinemas in large villages of the USSR, according to which it was planned to build 100 rural clubs. Firstly, the cinema had been built, and secondly, clearly not on a standard project. We see construction of 1953 in the village of Vasilivka, Poltava region. Something similar. The Solone theater looked somewhere about the same. Somewhere about are keywords. In Solone, it was a grandiose three-section structure, occupying almost a quarter. According to legend, Mendel Hatayevich, who had a summer cottage in neighboring Sergeyevka, got his hand in this. The first section contained the hall, including the dancing one, the second had the auditorium, and the third probably hosted library and administration. The theater was located as seen in the diagram. Construction of the theater began in 1934. Both non-residents and local staff were involved, and one of non-residents was Mikhailo Golik, born 1913. Just before that, in 1932, Mikhailo Golik received a degree in construction engineering at the Dnipropetrovsk Technical School of Municipal and Civil Construction. Rudolf Testlin himself, he is up in white shirt on, was head of the department of design and construction of Dnipropetrovsk. He was also an engineer teacher at this institution. Trestling's fate is tragic. He was shot in 1937 by NKVD. I even took his case in hand, but half of it is a long list of his property, which was confiscated from him, and his heirs tried to return it. It felt weird to me, and I left this case. Well, we returned to the theater. Construction material was poured into the formwork, and bricks were carried out on stretchers. Each collective farm allocated supplies and labor by order. 3 years later, the theater opened its doors, and the adjacent street was named Theatrical. There were drama, music and other clubs, a library and a cinema. In the evenings, dancing on the ground floor in the lobby, an orchestra played on the balcony of the second floor in the evenings. Appointments were made here, and well-dressed people gathered outside. There were small balconies on the stairs too, where villagers could stand in two or three and communicate, share impressions, enjoy life. Theatrical professional troops from big cities such as Dnipropetrovsk, Zaporizhia, and others came to Solone with performances. Kids slipped into the hall and hid behind the chairs. The tickets were blue, so the kids often cut them out of a 35 kopeck notebook and poked them at the controllers in the dark. This is how the theater looked unfinished. Further are quotes from Mykola Slesarenko memoirs. Mykola Slesarenko was born in 1926 in Solone. His memoirs are invaluable eyewitness accounts, so we can understand exactly what was happening back then. Moreover, this eyewitness is very observant and thinking. So commence the quote. At this time, we began to build a large theater in Solone. The Stalinist theory of the harmonious development of the individual was widespread in the Union back then. as property was destroyed and people had a lot of free time. And the fact was that somewhere in 1934-35 there was a general destruction of church rights and churches in our country. And then the church was completely destroyed. However, it was necessary to offer something new to occupy people at leisure. And then they decided to build a theater. It was located directly opposite the church, strictly to the south, i.e. occupied a plot of land from Theatrical Street to Kirov 1. A large park was planted near the theater. The theater itself was the best in the countryside, throughout the region, and even throughout the country. Auditorium for 600 seats, a large foyer, a ballroom, library, game room, and many more rooms for artistic and amateur art. Out of the stage was a large basement for decorations, and there was a boiler room. There was also a young builder, a technician, who supervised the construction. His last name was Golik. We had a girl at school, Govorun Lena. Her father died and she lived alone with her mother. Well, this Golik began to care for her mother and then married her. But Lena soon contracted tuberculosis and later died and was buried by Golik as a stepfather. According to the stories of those who were at the opening, there was a rally, then those who had money were allowed to go to the movies. This is the first sound film in Solone, and it was called Natalka-Poltavka in Ukrainian. Natalka was played for the first time by Petrusenko, and the elected Makogonenko was played by Patrozhinsky. The next day there were enthusiastic responses to the theater and the movies, so Vera and I started asking our mother for money for the movies, and our requests have now met with success. We were given 25 kopecks and we went to the movies after classes, or was it on the weekend, I don't remember exactly. I was very impressed by the movie, although I had seen a lot of movies before, but it was a sound movie. Anyway, I saw the first sound film in Solone, new cinema house. Although it was shown on one film camera, which caused breaks between parts while the device was recharging, but still the impression was very strong, and I sincerely believed in the communist future, as was already said back then at every meeting. In 1938, one after another, anti-fascist films such as Professor Mumlock, Swamp Soldiers, Karl Brunner and others were released in the cinema. End of quote. Fedorenko Trochim, who was also the director of the district magistrate, was named the director of the cinema. We'll remember him and we'll meet him in the next videos. The director of the theater was also Boris Kikut, born in 1908, a native of Dnipropetrovsk. We had met him in the video NKVD unit in the German-Soviet War 1941-1945. Petrenko Anatoly was an artist advertiser. Petrenko used to learn drawing well from his father and was engaged many times in drawing slogans and posters at school. When the movie theater was opened, he began to draw posters for money. The family lived on these earnings. We'll talk more about Petrenko's fate in next videos. Mykola Shevchenko was born in the village of Dymen, Rivne district, Kirovograd region in 1907. He took part in the work of the drama circle. From 1930 to 1938 he was working at the Red Partisan mine in the city of Chervonopartizansk in the Lugansk region. And before the war he moved to Solone, where he worked as a settlement operator with collective farms in a bank. Gnat Grinko, let's also remember him, who worked on the construction of the theater, was once instructed to find a projectionist. Grinko went to the cinema department of Dnipropetrovsk and brought from there Sinchenko Alexei, born in 1898, who had previously completed the relevant courses in Cherkasy, and in 1936 courses for projectionists of sound cinemas in Tashkent. In January 1940, Ivan Protsenko, born in 1907 in the village of Sergeyevka, became an assistant of the projectionist. Grigory Stomenko guarded the theater, while Hanna Potremets and Maria Stomenko cleaned the premises. Boyko Pavel was in charge of the fire brigade. Gordienko Mykola, born in 1918, was both cashier and artist. Alexandra Fedorko, a maiden name Osipenko, was also called as the artistic director. Alexandra, or diminutively Sasha, was born in 1916 in the village of Nizhny Sorogozy, Kherson region. Alexandra's father was head of one of the post offices in the Kherson region. Mother was a needlewoman, a wonderful hostess. The Osipenko family had three children. Smart Alexandra could read at the age of five, so her mother persuaded her father to send her to school early. The girl read poems in a loud voice and, diligently writing each digit, solved math problems. In 1937, after having graduated from seven classes, a 14-year-old girl decided to enter the Kharkiv theater studio. On the entrance exam, the members of the admission committee were fascinated by Fedorko's voice and accepted the young talent without hesitation. But when it came to paperwork, it turned out that the new student was a minor. Then, having invited Alexandra to his office, the director of the studio said that she should definitely come here next year, and for now he advised her to enter the theater college. He even wrote a note to his management to accept the girl without exams. But when Alexandra crossed the threshold of the school dormitory, saw dirty stairs, dark, uncomfortable rooms, she got scared. Can a talent really live here? Even a flower will dry up here, not that a person. If so, I don't want to be an artist. Then Sasha went to study at the Melitopol Medical College, from where in 1936 she transferred to the Dnipropetrovsk Medical Institute, and in 1939 to the university as the faculty of biology. It's clear that in addition to teaching, Sasha participated in various amateur concerts. At one of them, students performed in the Chengar regiment, what became a turning point for Sasha. There she met Fedorko Fedor, born in 1912 in the Zaporizhia region. Young people got married. Fedor became a graduate student of the Ukrainian Research Institute of Grain. In Vasilivka, Solona district, Fedor had a place for research work. After learning about the gorgeous cultural center in Solone, Alexandra's artistic soul darted there. The brass band was conducted by an extremely talented man, Mykola Derman. He was born on March 5, 1905 in Mazuricha, Bilsk County, Lublin Voivodeship, and had been involved in music since childhood. In 1926, Mykola was drafted into the Red Army, and somewhere on the Polish border he was wounded by a shell explosion, which caused him to walk with a limp. In Krasnoyarsk, Mykola graduated from accounting courses, and in 1929 he moved to Batumi, Georgia, Caucasus, where he worked as an accountant, and in his spare time played in the brass band of the port club on trumpet, clarinet and French horn. In 1935, Mykola Derman and his wife Yivga, a Czech by nationality, moved to the millionaire collective farm named after Chapayev, the village of Alexandrivka II, the Solona district. Yivga's brother Fedor Sladek already had lived there for some time. Fedor Sladek was also an amateur musician by vocation and worked as an accountant at the school. But when the theater opened in Solone, Mykola immediately moved to Solone and became the conductor of the brass band. Their children, Eugene, Edward and Lydia, were born there. But the German-Soviet war distorted both far-reaching plans and human destinies. Now is a quote from Cicely Sarenko's memoirs. The guys and I, Zhorka Yanchenko, Boris, etc., decided to go and see how people were sending to the front. The yard is warm, sunny, even hot. We are approaching the cinema. There are no movies here now, and the whole cinema is occupied by the military enlistment office. There are a lot of people near the cinema. Some are sitting under the fence or under trees, and many are crowded near a military man. He calls out the names, looking at the list in his hands, and everyone who hears his name collects his sack and goes to the side where another soldier builds the people into a column, forms groups. Each group includes four men. About 100 people are recruited, then the military commands, "At attention, forward march," and the column is silently moving away from the theater. End of quote. Many theater workers were evacuated and mobilized into the fighter battalion. Among them were Boris Kikut and Mykola Gordienko. Not everyone managed to go east, so the people was divided into three categories. The first one, Communist Party members, were going by cars and trucks. The second one, on horseback, and the rest, such as the Derman family, on oxen and by threshing machine. On August 18, 1941, they reached Volosky, but refugees were already rushing towards them and the crossing had been blown up, so there was nothing left but to come back to Solone. Mykola Gordienko reached the Orlovshina region at the formation point, and from there to Pavlograd. There the military commissar invited him to join Volobuyev's partisan detachment, which at the time was being formed in the Vasilivka or Dnipro region. But on the same day, Kikut, Drozd, Limarenko and Kozachenko came to the military commissar from the detachment. They talked to the military commissar about something, and that one sent Gordienko to the Pavlograd military enlistment office. In the area of Pologi station, Mykola's squad got surrounded. After a short stay in the Zaporizhia prisoner of war camp, Gordienko returned to Solone. There he was offered the position of director of the cinema, and a 23-year-old Mykola agreed because there was nothing wrong with that. He cleaned up the theater premises, formed a staff. On August 11, 1941, the military enlistment office sent Mykola Shevchenko to Pavlograd to serve in the 968th Regiment of the 255th Infantry Division. And on August 9, 1941, he was taken prisoner near the Baglay station and transferred to the Kryvyi Rih prisoner of war camp. In September 1941, Shevchenko returned to Solone and began working in the HTZ community farm on a threshing machine. But later he was recalled to the drama club. As I understand it, the drama circle was often recruited compulsory but made to appear as voluntarily. Ivan Protsenko was mobilized into the 97th Rifle Regiment. In September 1941, his platoon crossed the Samara River near Sinelnikovo. On the left bank, the fighters found themselves in isolation and wandered the fields for 2 days in search of the Soviet army, until they were besieged. On the way to Kryvyi Rih POW camp, they stopped in Dnipropetrovsk. Protsenko saw a group of civilians there and quickly joined them, so he managed to escape. Returning to Solone, he began to earn a living by his long-standing shoemaker's trade. In January 1942, he had to agree to work as a projectionist in the theater, that is, to replace Sinchenko Alexei, who became chief of the police. We will somehow talk about his difficult destiny. Alexandra Fedorko gave birth to a daughter, Valentina, on June 18, 1941, 4 days before the war. In June 1941, her husband was mobilized to the front. As it was very tough in the city during the war with the baby, so she was forced to move to the village of Vasilivka at the place of her husband's experimental work. Soon the village was surrounded by Germans, but when after some time the railway resumed its work, she returned to Dnipropetrovsk. In the spring of 1942, Alexandra moved to Solone. In October 1941, the Germans organized a meeting of the population with the German authorities. Mykola Derman was required to prepare a brass band for the event, but Mykola said, "There is no one to collect the orchestra. Some are at the front, others are in the evacuation. After that, Derman was arrested, and it's unknown how it would have ended if the police chief Sinchenko hadn't taken him from the gendarmerie, promising the Germans to solve this on his own. Sinchenko brought Mykola to the police building, took a lash, and commenced weeping on the table, Derman being ordered to shout with all his might. Then Sinchenko let him go with the advice to grow quiet and not to mix up in anything. Gradually, the Solone Theater, with a staff of 30 employees, resumed its activities. It was Sinchenko, head of police, who was appointed chief of the theater, because he had previously been a cinema mechanic and, secondly, wasn't deprived of his creative abilities. Amateur directors were Shevchenko and even Marko Longinov, born in 1924, driver. The Longinov was an interesting family. Longinova, a maiden name of Duhina Claudia, was born in 1891 in the village of Ivankovo, Kashiro district, Moscow region. Her father worked as a typewriter in Moscow, but in 1906 she was sent to Ekaterinoslav for participating in the 1905 revolution. Then he left for Lugansk. In 1908 he was sent to the Tobolsk province. In 1917 he returned to Ekaterinoslav and died in 1921. In 1920, Claudia and her husband Ivan Longinov came to Solone, bought a house, two horses, two carriages, a wheelbarrow, and all the agriculture equipment. Her husband comes from the Nikolaev generals. In 1931, the Longinov were dispossessed. Claudia went to Moscow and somehow managed to get her property back on the instructions of the USSR prosecutor. Naturally, Claudia hated the communists, especially those who adapted to both Soviet and German rules, and especially those who had taken her property away. Until 1938, Claudia was a housewife, then worked as a silk chemist in the collective farm Red Village. She still had 1.75 hectares of orchard in her possession and even prescribed some seeds from abroad, almost from the United States. In 1938, the Solone District Executive Committee decided to confiscate the garden and transfer it to the HTZ collective farm. It's clearer that Claudia immediately began to write complaints to higher authorities, but it didn't help. 1.5 hectares of the garden were confiscated and handed over to the HTZ collective farm. Her another son, Viktor, was born in 1917. He was a gliding instructor in the Red Army and was sentenced for a plane crash while working at the Dnipropetrovsk airfield. Viktor was given 2 years in prison. Claudia also had a daughter, Clementine, born in 1926. Further is a quote from Sisarenko's memoirs. Longinov was a surveyor in the regional land department. He was a land surveyor by education, and that is why he was known as a surveyor. He lived permanently in Dnipropetrovsk, but somewhere in 1935, his wife Claudia and children began to live permanently in Solone. Claudia was said to have had frequent quarrels with her husband Longinov. Therefore, the land surveyor's wife lived longer in Solone, while the surveyor lived longer in Dnipropetrovsk. They had 2 children, Marik, born in 1923, and Clementine, Klema, born in 1926. Mark was at the same grade as I, and Clementine 1 class higher. But as I have already mentioned, Mark and Clementina constantly started attending our school somewhere in 1935, and before that they had studied at school in Dnipropetrovsk. Mark was quite a sociable guy, very enterprising. Although both the surveyor and his wife were black-haired Jews, Mark had red hair. End of the quote. Ivan Protsenko was also an electrician. Ignatenko Viktor, born 1921, was a controller. Films were shown twice a week, both German and pre-war Soviet ones. Before the session, there must be new reels about the German army successes. And in May 1942, they managed to bring from Dnipropetrovsk an excerpt from the film Hopak, which lasted 8 minutes. It was launched instead of the second part of the German newsreel, but 3 minutes later there was a noise of discontent in the hall. After showing the movie, Sinchenko arrived and got on Protsenko and his assistant, but in order to lift the spirits of his home folks, Ivan Protsenko sometimes broadcast Soviet songs on the radio. The drama circle involved 22 actors, whose salary was 400 karbovanets. Among them are Zinchenko Ivan, Sukhorukova Maria, Longinova Clementina, Klemma, Troyan Juravel Nadezhda, born in village Novon Sanjari, Poltava region. She was Sinchenko's civil wife. Sisters Kotenko, Dina and Lina, Papuk Vera from the village Vasilivka, Potoremets Viktor, Slesarenko Vera, Lubchenko Vasil, Kalyuzhnaya Taisiya. The German authorities demanded that all Ukrainian plays be staged. Dnipropetrovsk newspaper of April 27, 1943, reported that the first production was Staritsky's drama Don't Go to Gritz Party, and at the end of November 1941 in the repertoire were already such performances as The Courtship at Goncharivka, Natalka-Poltavka, etc. The repertoire was coordinated with the head of the Theater Sinchenko and the Department of Public Education at the District Administration. During October-November 1941, they gave 24 performances and 42 concerts. At the request of spectators, some performances were repeated several times. So, Don't Go to the Gritsy Party was played in Solone 4 times. The string circle was headed by Semen Gulyayev, born in Stalin in 1916. His assistant was the most talented violinist, Peter Vyskarka, born in 1927, a native of the village of Ovnigi. Peter started playing music at the age of 4 when he found an old violin in the attic. Then they got a bow, and at the age of 7 he had already won the district competition. The boy's parents sent him to the Dnipropetrovsk music boarding school, and with the beginning of the war, Peter came to the new world, Novy Svit. This is a village near Solone, where his grandparents lived. The brass band has also resumed its work. Among the musicians, Babenko Mykola, born in 1921, and Peter Morozenko from Basmachka. Mykola Derman and his brother-in-law, Fedor Sladek, were helping the orchestra. Before the new year of 1942, Mykola Gordienko resigned from the directorate and turned to the position of cashier and worked there until October 1943. He also wrote billboards and announcements about the production in the cinema. Propaganda posters required a specific typographic font, so they were sent from the council. In parallel, Gordienko was taking part in the work of the drama club. In the spring of 1942, Alexandra Fedorko came to Solone with her 20-year-old brother Mykola Osipenko, a baby daughter, and her mother, Osipenko Daria. Alexandra became the director of the theater and the artistic director of the drama club, and her brother got a job as a controller. Slysarenko's long quote will help us imagine the time. Who but an eyewitness can tell better? Beze ordered the cinema to be prepared for the threshing grain. The bread was in full swing. The Germans took all the grain from the thresher in military vehicles and collective farm carriages and dumped it in the cinema. When there was enough grain, the Germans sent their military trucks, mostly Opel, covered with tarpaulins. Depending on the amount of grain, 15-20 trucks came and took away all the grain that was dumped in the cinema. The winter of 1942 was snowy, but not very frosty, and this contributed to an active pastime. Commandant Beze gave permission for our cinema to operate. There again, as before the war, various circles began to resume their activities: string circle, drama circle, rhythmic dance circle, etc. This was greatly facilitated by the fact that we had many prisoners of war in Solone, among whom were good musicians. Then two professional dancers appeared from somewhere, Bolgov and Alyoshkin. Besides, Alyoshkin was a circus artist in general and therefore knew a lot of clowning, circus sideshows, etc. I expressed a desire to participate in a string circle. Back in school, our tenant, pharmacist, taught me to play the balalaika quite tolerably, and I, on boyish naivety, thought that in the club I would be able to develop even more my ability to play the balalaika. My mother didn't object as long as I didn't join any guerrilla sabotage organization. Thus, life had become so normal that I no longer felt the presence of the Germans at all, and the appearance of such active personalities as Bolgov, Alyoshkin, Semen Golyaev, and others made life even more interesting than it had been before the war. In addition, the police functioned normally, making sure that there were no riots or questionable meetings, but didn't restrict business activities. Therefore, immediately after the departure of military units from Solone, private workshops, shops and something similar began to open. The opening of the cinema was greatly facilitated by the chief of our police, Silchenko, who was a cinema mechanic here before the war. He was very close in spirit to Commandant Beise and therefore managed to find common ground with him. Our police didn't yet have their uniforms and all were dressed in civilian clothes, and only on the sleeve of the right hand wore a white bandage, of course, only during the service. The rest of the time no one wore bandages, and it was difficult to determine what kind of person he was, whether he was a policeman or not. But there was already a rumor of the imminent arrival of the German commissioner, and that the police would soon have their own uniform. In addition to circles in the cinema, German films were shown almost every week, both for German soldiers who were sometimes on leave from frontline wars and for the local population. Moreover, Commandant Beise was even more inclined to show films to the public, as he liked to say, to educate them in the spirit of European culture. Organizing circles, we began to spend time actively and prepare for performances in front of our villagers. The string circle was led by Semen Golyaev. He was a prisoner of war, and it seemed to me that he used to be a commander. Apparently aware of this, he behaved very carefully and tried to catch the eye of the Germans as little as possible. He was tall, black-haired, but his very primitive civilian clothes made him a completely inconspicuous man. Maybe that's what he wanted. He appeared in Solone not long ago. At first he was very thin and ragged, but then gradually recovered. And by the beginning of spring he was quite a good man. He played the mandolin very well. Several people from the captives lived in a collective farm in a stable, where they were provided with food and housing. During the day they worked on the collective farm, and in the evenings Semen and others of his friends came to the theater in order to participate in circles. There were 12 of us in the circle, and I don't remember them all, but I know that Ivan Semenovich Ignatenko, a friend of my father, played the balalaika with me in a pair. He too was in captivity, but the Germans released him because he lived in Solone, which was already far behind the German front line. He also lived in our gliding street right after Timoha Karafet. It was very convenient for me because we went home together after rehearsals. And although he was much older than me, he always talked to me as an equal. The drama circle was led by Shevchenko. He was already an elderly man, a bit like the present-day artist Kost Stepankov. Before the war, he also worked here in the cinema as an artistic director. Police Chief Sinchenko and his new living girlfriend Juravel also took an active part in the drama club. Bolgov and Alyoshkin organized rhythmic dances, and they had several of our boys who learned to knock out the tap. but only Bulgov and Alyoshkin took part in the performances, as learning to knock out a tap is not such a simple thing, and it took time to master it. That's why only few guys attended rehearsals. However, two sisters appeared in Solone from somewhere. It was said that they had come from Dnipropetrovsk because it was pretty hungry there, and they settled in Solone in search of food and lived in a stable where our prisoners of war were staying. They also worked on the collective farm and in the evenings went to the theater for amateur performances. The older sister was probably in her 30s. Her name was Pavlina. She was married and her husband was at the front somewhere. They had no children. She participated in a drama club. Her younger sister, under the age of 20, participated in a rhythmic dance group. She already knew how to do many tricks. It was said that she had studied at a circus school in Dnipropetrovsk. I don't know her name, but she was much more interesting and beautiful than her sister Pavlina, even though she was red-haired. They both came from Dnipropetrovsk in a rather deplorable condition. It was obvious that they were really hungry and they had nothing left to exchange for food, but after some time working on the collective farm, they both recovered, especially the younger one, and now they felt quite confident. Well, this junior kept company Alyoshkin and Bulgov in performances, and when they three were knocking out the tap, they did this so famously that it was taking our breath away. You could feel that they are real professionals. But since Bulgov was a little older and tried to command in this group, and Alyoshkin was more professional and didn't want to obey Bulgov, Alyoshkin and Pavlina's younger sister worked more often together. Rehearsals were carried out separately for each group in rooms, and after learning my balalaika part, I went on stage and watched the rhythm rehearsal with great interest. I watched with excessive pleasure and envied how clearly and variously Bulgov and Alyoshkin were knocking out taps, how remarkably the plastic figures were performed by Alyoshkin and Pavlina the sister. I had never seen anything like that. Later, we got two very important participants in the circles. One was Peter, a student of the Dnipropetrovsk Music School of the second year in the violin class. Peter himself is a native of a village in the Solone district. He was a very capable boy, and so he was sent to music school. He had managed to finish 2 years of school, and then the war prevented further study. He came to his house, but only his mother and grandfather were at home. His father was at the front, and there was no news from him. Peter learned through some acquaintances that circles had been organized in the theater and decided to take part in their work. It's good for him because he will get at least some practice. He already played very well and made a pretty interesting pair with our Shevchenko, who also knew how to play the violin, though not as professionally as Peter. They always performed together and quite well. Peter sometimes took part in our string circle. The second was a young girl, aged 20-22, very beautiful and intelligent. The only drawback I've always noticed in her was the peculiar pronunciation of the letter C, as if her tongue was stuck between her teeth. Obviously, she knew about it, and it was always felt in the conversation that when she was uttering this letter, she was making some effort to pronounce it correctly. But it wasn't always possible, and her conversation wasn't very pleasant to the ear. She played the piano. She was also a student at a music school, like Peter, but she was already a graduate and played professionally. She lived here in Solone with a relative. This cohort of professional musicians and dancers created the interesting cultural atmosphere that prevailed in the theater. I want to draw attention again to the fact that it was again in a group of people older than me. I was the youngest there, and only one boy from the rhythmic dance group was 2 years younger than me. But this group of teenage boys was somehow isolated and had no influence on the work of the clubs. After all, they never performed in front of the public because have not yet been able to master the rhythm to such an extent that Alyoshkin Pushkin and Bulgakov decided to release them on stage. Obviously, my destiny kept me under the patronage of older people. Sometime in early February, we were suddenly offered to perform before German officers and soldiers, who periodically came to Solone for a 2 or 3 day break from the front. This proposal was unexpectedly brought by Sinchenko himself. At that time, our drama club was rehearsing the play Nazar Stodola by Shevchenko. Nazar was just played by the elder Zhuravel, and Galia, his lover, was played by his beautiful ex-wife. Galia's father, Homa, was first played by our Shevchenko, but then Sinchenko urgently changed parts and began to prepare this part himself, while Shevchenko started learning another part. Our esteemed orchestra was to open this evening of amateur performances, and then we had to change into Cossacks and participate in the mass scenes of Nazar Stodola. Actually, the rehearsals were more intense than before. Sinchenko showed enviable persistence. He studied Homa's words hard and hurried everyone to study parts. Most of all, he scolded Juravel's ex-wife and Pavlina, who played Galia's mother. Thus, Sinchenko, Homa, Galia's father, and Pavlina, Galia's mother, had to play spouses. A few days later, Beze came to the rehearsal and surprisingly behaved very friendly and favorably. He was wondering if he needed any props, makeup, clothes, tools, etc. I didn't take part in all this, and all negotiations were conducted by seniors and leaders, such as Shevchenko. Finally, the rehearsals were over and they set a night for the concert. Advertisements were placed around the village. Whoever wants can go to the theater to watch amateur art. The night of the concert came. On stage, everybody is on the move. We were preparing the scenery for Nazar Stodola. Dolgov and Alyoshkin were checking their equipment. While we were tuning our musical instruments, our performance was to open the concert. We quickly place our chairs on the stage in a semicircle. I hear the sound of voices in the hall, people settling in their seats. Suddenly, Beze came on stage and began to say Sinchenko something through an interpreter. Both faces are cheerful. Beze patted Sinchenko on the shoulder with his hand. Come on, don't be shy. Beze left, we sat down and waited for the curtain to open. I hear the interpreter make an announcement in the fourth stage. The point was that Commandant Beze commissioned a small concert for German soldiers and officers, as well as for locals. There will be a musical number, performances by clowns, rhythmic dances, and a small play based on Ukrainian motifs, where the main part will be played by the head of the local police, Mr. Sinchenko. There will be applause from the German officers sitting in the front rows, and the applause of the whole hall. The interpreter announced the performance of the string orchestra and went behind the scenes. The curtain opened and we were in front of the auditorium. I found myself in the farthest chair and the whole hall was in front of me like the palm of my hand. To my right, Ivan Semyonovich, and further the other members of the orchestra. Semen Golyaev, as the leader, was in the middle, and all our eyes were on him. I personally glanced at the auditorium and saw German officers sitting in the front two rows. The pompous Commandant Beze was in the middle of the front row, and next to him, apparently, the commander of the military unit that has come to have a rest. Then a little more than half of the auditorium was occupied by German soldiers, and then our locals were already sitting. There were not so many of them, about 100 people, mostly young men and women. The hall was nearly full, which is 400 seats without a balcony. Then I look askance at Semen Golyaev. He nods invisibly and we start playing our first item. I remember it was a waltz over the waves, then we played Shining Moon, Krakowian, in total 5 or 6 items. After the last one, everyone took his chair and began to leave the stage. I glance at the auditorium again. Our performance didn't have a favorable effect on the audience. I see the boring faces of the Germans and some condescending smiles. Of course, the performance of a string ensemble of 12 people was of no interest for them, and I myself wasn't happy with it, and not because we played unprofessionally, but because the repertoire was so naive and beaten that another reaction from the audience wasn't to be expected. We all gathered in our room and I hear Semen Golyaev speak disapprovingly, but suddenly Shevchenko comes in and waves his hand with a smile. Well, that will be fine. Then came the performances of rhythmic dancers, but before that Alyoshkin came on stage with a little clowny, where he portrayed Harlequin, and did it so professionally that the Germans came to life in the hall. I was watching this performance from behind the scenes and admired Alyoshkin. Somehow it didn't occur to me that such an artist in the daytime wears tarpaulin boots, a soldier's tunic, and for some reason a sailor's jacket. After Alyoshkin's performance on stage, Shevchenko and Peter play several items on violins, and at this time Alyoshkin takes off his motley collar in the dressing room and prepares for performances with Bolgov and Pavlina's younger sister. I go behind the scenes again to watch their dances, and although it's not so good to see from this position, but I again admire a few harmonious rhythmic dances. The Germans have already recognized Alyoshkin and enthusiastically welcome his appearance on stage. Apparently, his clowning had a positive effect. And finally, in conclusion, Nazar Stodola. All of us who no longer participate in the performances change into Cossacks and prepare to participate in mass scenes. I don't know how the Germans understood this play, but they reacted to Sinchenko's appearance on stage with applause, especially the officers. Obviously, Sinchenko was well represented by Commandant Beze to his compatriots. Due to lack of presentability, I didn't participate in the scenes, and only once in the last act of the play I was allowed to go out on stage in the general mass of Cossacks. This lasted no more than 5 minutes, but during this time I have a chance to look into the auditorium again. The Germans got a bit lively. No doubt they liked the play of Sinchenko himself, and he played well, and most likely the songs that Juravel performed during the performance, playing the part of Gnat. When the performance ended, not very friendly applause was heard in the hall, and all the locals and the Germans left the hall with roars and knocks. Later they went home. No one felt wartime at all back then, and I felt the same way I did in the pre-war school performances. Beze and two other officers went into the dressing room and congratulated Sinchenko on a good performance. I see Commandant Beze for the first time with a smile on his face. His companions are also smiling, saying something in German, and I can only guess that this is something approving. Late in the evening we all go home, but on the way we aren't talking about the concert, but about more prosaic things, how and where to get a job, to work better and live better. We agree on something, give some addresses. I participate in these conversations only as a listener. I don't need to settle down anywhere and do not need to think about where to live better. After the concert, we have a few days off. We don't attend rehearsals. I go to my street company of Kolesu. There you can hear the latest news, and there was something I could tell. About a day after the concert, we gathered at Kolesu's house in our usual lineup. About 6 o'clock in the evening, I do not remember who, but one of the latter reports that right now he saw two policemen near Makitka Kotenko's house, who came out of the house and talked about something and mentioned a boy's name. Then someone said that in the afternoon the police took all our partisans to the police. Of this, I knew only Usenko because he worked on our collective farm, and sometimes in the morning I met him at the foreman's. I remembered him as such a rather tall man with a white head, not gray, and his mustache much the same beaten. On his feet are good tarpaulin boots. He wears soldier's trousers, black sweatshirt. He has a bag rolled into a tube. That's how I last saw him. Klema, Mark Longinov's sister, my classmate since the fifth grade. Clementina was 1 year older than me, and in 1942 she was 17 years old. But she studied one class lawyer. She was a very beautiful girl, and it couldn't be said that she was the sister of Mark, who was red, but freckles on his face. Clementine was black with a very pleasant and pretty face. We no longer held rehearsals for concerts, but simply for cultural time. After all, except for the theater, the Germans didn't allow large gatherings of young people. Although it was under the control of the police, they weren't very diligent in this matter, and people quietly gathered in interest groups. Only no drunkenness and loud parties were allowed. Then there was offensive on Kharkiv in May 1942. But even at that time we were going to the theater as if for a rehearsal, but no one wanted to rehearse, and there was more talk about the offensive of our troops. Former prisoners of war were especially worried. Of course, I didn't understand them. It seemed to me that everyone should rejoice at the arrival of our troops. But when, much later, I learned how our troops actually treated the liberated people, the prisoners of war in particular, I didn't condemn them, but on the contrary, I was sympathetic with them. Gradually, the cannonade at first receded and then subsided. The Germans said that the Red Army had broken, indeed, through the front near Kharkiv, but as a result of persistent fighting, several thousand fighters were surrounded and taken prisoners. Many died, many wounded. Now the Germans took Kharkiv again and launched an offensive on the Caucasus and the Volga. A few days later, on Sunday, we gathered in the theater as usual and during rehearsals discussed the recent offensive of our troops in the Kharkiv area. Suddenly, our Shevchenko was summoned to Commandant Base. About in half an hour, he came back and said that the commandant required to throw small celebrations on the occasion of the German victory near Kharkiv and wanted our orchestra to give a small concert directly to the commandant just in his apartment. Of course, we got very at once. Personally, I felt some remorse. It seemed to me that I shouldn't go to the commandant. I saw how Semen Golaev also frowned a little but still continued to discuss to go or not to go. Of course, the elders understood that Beze wouldn't be indifferent if he didn't come to his place. This was especially felt by the prisoners of war, because they well understood that Beze was well aware of who was who, and it costed him nothing to put prisoners of war under firing squad. But while we were arguing, Sinchenko himself suddenly came running and made us go now. Of course, there was nothing left to do but go to the commandant. It was about afternoon. The day was warm and sunny. The area is already full of greenery. We took our instruments and went with the whole orchestra. There were 15 of us. From the cinema to the commandant office was about 200 meters, and we quickly came to the place. We were already met on the spot by a military fritz, who invited us to a veranda open to all winds, and there were already chairs, and we sat down in our proper places. I was watching with interest some tumult inside the apartment. I already knew this long corridor and many doors leading to different offices. We were immediately asked to play some fun tune. The man gave the command and we started playing. At that moment, some employees, Germans, of the commandant's office came out of the rooms. They were listening to our playing with interest, standing under the wall. After the end of the first song, everyone clapped approvingly. The Germans somehow came to life. Beze himself appeared in a pretty good spirits. Sometime in early July 1942, perhaps in late June, they asked us to go to the village and give a concert for the local population. The village of Vovnigi, which was located near the Dnipro rapids, was chosen as such a village. There was the most terrible rapid, insatiable. I don't know what kind of idea it was, but they gave us a car and issued all the passes, gave us fuel. The car was a ZIS-5. The driver turned out to be Sashko Bondarenko, a relative of our grandmother Yivga. Sashko appeared in Solone not so long ago, but he felt quite confident. I have a suspicion that both Sashko Bondarenko and this venture with a trip to Vovnigi are connected with some secret task, some secret organization, but I didn't suspect anything like that back then. We gathered near the theater. The day was quite unfavorable, cloudy, rain clouds all around and even splashing rain. Someone questioned whether it was worth going and giving a concert on such a day, especially since many knew this village Vovnigi. There wasn't even a suitable place for a concert, but those who started the event said that everything would be fine. In case of rain, a large tarpaulin was thrown into the body and it did us a good service from the headwind. We left quite late, but Vovnigi isn't so far from Solone and this distance wasn't big for the truck. We went to the village. The village of Vovnigi itself is a small, located at the top of a large cliff. This cliff was cut by the waters of the Dnipro and formed that famous rapid. When we came to the village, no one there knew about our arrival. Sashko Bondarenko and someone else found a local mayor and asked to invite people to the concert. There was no room, and that's why we decided to give a concert in the open air. Thankfully, there was a small area equipped with benches for sitting. Rhythmic artists decided to dance right in the body of the truck, freeing it from the benches and reclining the boards. While all this was getting ready, we all decided to look at the Dnipro. I went up the cliff and saw a lot of stones below, probably 30 or 40 meters away, and a lot of water branches. It was said that when the Dnipro dam blocked the flow of the river, the water completely flooded all the stones and rose to the top of the cliff, and all sorts of steamships passed along the Dnipro. But now the dam was open, all the water went into the Black Sea, the rapids got exposed, and the Dnipro became as it was before the construction of the dam. We descended from the cliff down to the very stones. Jumping from stone to stone, we reached almost the middle of the Dnipro, but there was a fairly wide branch and it was impossible to just jump over it. Apparently, during the Zaporizhian siege, various Cossack boats like seagulls crossed the rapids on this very branch. In this place of Vovnigi, the width of the rapids was somewhere at the level of 150-200 meters, but the water branches were no more than 25-30 meters wide. The water in the branches flowed so fast that you couldn't even insert your hand. There was a continuous noise of flowing water, and above the stones there was a mist of spray. Somehow I didn't even believe that this is the famous Dnipro, which is so much talked about in stories about the Zaporizhian siege. Cloudy weather further emphasized the sinister nature of these rapids. I was standing on one of the boulders, and to the sound of the water, the pictures from Yavronitsky's book History of the Zaporizhia Cossacks, which I had read in the pre-war period, just popped up in my mind. It was this monotonous noise, these rapid streams of water rushing with a water mist over the boulders, that threw me into the times of Sagaidachny and Bohdan Khmelnytsky, gave me a feeling of freedom and independence, a feeling of strength and prudence. Obviously, this atmosphere made all the people in the Zaporizhian siege wholehearted. Wholeheartedly brave and strong, wholeheartedly devoted to their land. It was the rapids that made the newcomers zealous Cossacks. They called us from the shore and everyone went up on the cliff. Everything was already prepared for the concert, but where are spectators? Personally, I counted not more than a dozen of them, six young people and the elderly. We started the concert according to the usual scheme. First a performance by a string orchestra, then solo numbers and rhythmics. It wasn't entirely clear that during the concert none of our leaders could be seen. Just when the concert was over, Sashko Bondarenko and Aura Shevchenko appeared. Only now did I suspect that the concert was a cover for a meeting, and perhaps it was in Vovnigi that there was some underground headquarters. We got home without problems, without any special adventures. This was the last concert I took part in. End of the long quote. Fedorko was the director for only a few months. After that, the theater was headed by Shevchenko for some time. Finally, the administrative functions were divided among all theater workers, because it got weird to head the theater. Why weird? The spacious premises of the theater made it possible to establish prison cells. They also gathered those who were waiting to be sent to Germany. Longinov sometimes allowed himself anti-German remarks, and when the Soviet troops went on the offensive, Shevchenko, Fedorko, Sukhorukova, Lubchenko, Vyskarka, Slysarenko, and Kalyuzhnaya suddenly burst into Soviet songs. If there is a war tomorrow, and armor is stone and our tanks are fast. When Sinchenko was informed about this, he screwed up and had educational conversations with the actors, prescribing them 15 blows with a rubber hose. As for Fedorko, she was staying for 2 weeks in a cell which was located in an usual country house. Her neighbor was a Kyiv singer from the Zirka choir. The girl sometimes sang Ukrainian songs in such a way that the Germans themselves listened to them with pleasure. Police Chief Sinchenko personally took Fedorko in for questioning and advised her not to close the door behind when she entered the German officer's office. Alexandra was released on the condition that she will prove that she wasn't a member of the Komsomol. The girl went to Dnipropetrovsk University, where a dean, Gustav YAKOBOVSKY, gave her such a certificate. In August 1943, the theater celebrated the Harvest Festival and organized an agriculture exhibition. This photo was taken in the Solone Theater. In October 1943, when the Soviet troops were already approaching Solone, the head of the theater, Sinchenko, ordered Ivan Protsenko to put all the film equipment and theatrical costumes in a chest and take them to Dnipropetrovsk for all Ukrainian photo cinema administration. On October 25, 1943, during the retreat, the Germans for some reason blew up the theater and thus ended its short 6-year history. There was one column left, which the children weren't allowed to approach, as it could fall at any moment. The orchestra pit housed food, grain. So, in the famine of 1947, the people of Solone went to the scene of conflagration and collected the remains of burnt groats there. Upon the return of Soviet power, many men were mobilized to the front. Mykola Gordienko fought as a radio operator in the 965th Baltic Rifle Regiment, was awarded the Medal for Courage and two orders of the Red Star. When he returned to Solone, he was immediately arrested and given to 10 years in camps for being taken prisoner and drawing theatrical posters. After serving his term, Mykola returned to Solone and lived there until old age, surrounded by loyal friends and a loving family. Protsenko Ivan disobeyed the order of Sinchenko. After meeting the Soviet troops, he handed over the film equipment to the district executive committee and went to the front, where he fought until October 1945. He was awarded the medals for courage, for military merit, for victory over Germany. Protsenko was arrested in 1947 and got 10 years in prison, formally for acting as a theater director, but the fact that his father had been repressed and friendship with Sinchenko were aggravating circumstances. Shevchenko was of proletarian origin and he officially headed the theater for several months, but he was only a witness in this case. After having spent 8 years in the camps, Protsenko returned to Solone. Golik worked for many years as a surveyor in the road department, a foreman in the Solone District Consumers Union, and in a poultry farm. He died in 1985. Sukhorukova Maria was still in 1947 an economist at the Central Statistical Office in Solone, but then urgently left for Berestechko-Volyn region, where she worked in the district land department. Goliaev's man went to the front and went missing there in December 1943. As for Marko Longinov, Slisarenko was with him in Germany. Commence the quote. About a week before I left for Germany, I was told that Mark Longinov had been taken to the police for some reason and had been in the cell for several days. Every day, six of them are taken out for cleaning up, and I saw Mark there. He was quite cheerful and boldly argued with the police. Finally, he was offered a choice, either to go to Germany or he will be sent to prison in Dnipropetrovsk. He, of course, chose Germany. He was released 3 days before he was sent to collect some things at home, then in Germany. Since Mark Longinov always worked only in the day shift and I worked in the night shift, we were separated by the time of relocation. Mark took his bed in the evening and I had to take the bed the next morning. So it turned out that Mark settled next to the Dnipropetrovsk guys, and when I came in the morning, I had to look for a free place. But I wasn't upset by this circumstance. Mark and I weren't very often together. He had his own interests and I had my own. We mustn't forget that Mark was 3 years older than me, but we didn't break the friendship, and often in the evenings after work we shared our impressions and news. Working in the Congress, we formed our own group. Vovka Dubina, Ivan Kirienko, Mykola Stadnik, Misha Kornilov and me. There were five of us working. Vovka Kudin got into another group and another shift, and Mark Longinov, even before the terrible bombing which destroyed our entire plant, escaped from the camp because he had some friction with the German administration and was threatened with being sent to a concentration camp. He didn't take any chances and left the camp during one of the next bombing. I gave him one of my suits, which Mark managed to save at the time of the bombing of our camp in 1943. A few days later, I suddenly received a letter from Mark, of course without a return address. I learned from the text that Mark had dropped the letter in the mailbox at Platlit station, and then I received another another letter where he had already mentioned the city of Passau. This is already an Austrian city, so Mark was driving south. I didn't get anything more from Mark, and I still don't know where Mark's final stop was. The end of quote. On November 4, 1943, Klavdia Lunginova was arrested, and on February 19, 1944, she was tried and given 10 years in prison. She wrote a complaint in 1948, but it wasn't satisfied. The fates of her children Clementina and Victor are also unknown. Mykola Shevchenko was sent to Germany in March 1943. After the victory, he returned to Solone, and in 1946 he left for Pervomaisk, Lugansk region, at the Red Partisan mine. Kikut Boris went missing in January 1944. Vyskarka Peter. In 1943 he was drafted into the army. He fought as a machine gunner in the maneuverable force of the 24th Border Regiment of the NKVD troops. He was awarded the Medal of Merit, the Order of the Patriotic War of the second degree. In 1959 he graduated from the Moscow Conservatory and worked as a concertmaster on the symphony orchestra of the Dnipropetrovsk Philharmonic. In 1972, Vyskarka was awarded the title of Honored Artist of the USSR. He died in 1996. I called his wife 3 years ago, but she was seriously ill and said that all the photos had been taken away by some journalists. After the liberation of Solone from the Germans, the Derman family immediately left for Krasnodar and did the right thing. Fedor Sladek emigrated to the Czech Republic in 1947 because he was a secretary in the Solone administration under the Germans. Later, the Dermans moved to the city of Zhytomyr for permanent residence. Mykola Derman played the trumpet in a brass band in the Zhytomyr local park for some time, but then sold the clarinet and the French horn. He never returned to music but willingly taught others. He died in 1973. When the Soviet power returned to Solone, Alexander Fedorkov was mobilized to work in the district military enlistment office as the head of the military accounting desk. Her husband, Fedorkov Fedor, died in battle on July 6, 1943. In the spring of 1944, as soon as the University of Dnipropetrovsk began to work, Alexander returned to finish her studies. She worked as a researcher at the Botanical Garden at Dnipropetrovsk University, took postgraduate courses in absentia. In 1947, Alexandra married Mikhail Yablochny, gave birth to 2 sons, Yuri and Eugen. She worked in different cities of Ukraine, first in the Kirovograd region, in the reserve Mary Bukovenki, then moved to Genichis, closer to her mother. There she worked as a researcher at the Azov Sivash Reserve. During 5 years, from 1957 to 1963, she was planting trees and gardens on Biruchi Island in the Sea of Azov. In 1965, Alexandra got a job at Simferopol State University and became the director of the Park Salgirka. In 1997, she suffered a stroke and never left her room since then. During the interview, Vladimir Orekhov somehow squeezed something out of her about her life in Solone. This shows that until her death in 2010, Alexandra had considered the head of the Solone police, Sinchenko, as an underground fighter. We'll try to talk about Sinchenko separately. The remains of the once majestic theater building got gradually dismantled, and a kindergarten and fire station were built on the site. Theater Street was renamed in honor of the partisan Stomenko in the 1960s. Then another club was built in Solone, now it's in a state of emergency. Don't switch, subscribe. I have accumulated a lot of material, the most interesting is ahead.